You sure you don't mind eating outside?
Not at all. The sun feels great.
Oh, God, I feel like I haven't seen you in ages.
Oh, I know.
You look wonderful. You really do.
Thank you.
We were worried about you.
Really?
Well, you disappeared on us.
Oh, I didn't mean to.
I'd leave messages and you wouldn't call me back right away.
I know. I'm sorry. I needed some time to myself, you know?
You're not mad at me or anything, are you?
Mad at you? Why should I be mad at
you?
Well,
I don't know. You know, when this thing happened, we talked all the time.
I know.
You dropped by all the time. And then after a while...
I thought you were getting sick of me.
No!
I was getting sick of me.
No, I wasn't. I are you sure that I didn't offend you in some way?
Karen, why would you have offended me?
Well, you don't think that on some level you blame me for this whole thing?
Oh, God, that's ridiculous.
Well, was my idea to introduce you.
Well, so what? We were grown-ups. We knew what we were doing.
Yeah, but I mean, I set this whole thing in motion. All the rancor and rage, the pain the kids are going
through. It was out of your control, Karen. That we came together was as much out of your control as our falling apart. You can't control everything, even though you'd like to think you can.
So I guess you immersed yourself in your work all this time, which was probably the healthiest thing that you could have done.
Actually, no. I haven't been in my studio in weeks.
How come?
The pressure to paint has totally lifted.
Oh, well, that'll pass.
Oh, I'm not worried about it. I don't want to paint anymore.
Why not?
Well, right after Tom left, this unburdening happened, and I looked at what I've been doing with my life, and it seemed totally insignificant to me.
No.
Yes. I realized that Tom was right. I was using my painting as an excuse not to get on with my life.
Well, how can you say that? After all these years, all that hard work?
Oh, let's face it, I was never very good.
That is not true. You are very good.
Karen, you don't have to say that anymore.
I like your stuff.
Well, it's okay, but I'm over it. It's not important anymore.
Wow. So, what have you been doing with yourself this winter?
Well, therapy, twice a week.
Good.
And I'm seeing someone.
Oh, you little devil. Isn't that great?
Oh, it is. He's a wonderful man.
What's his name?
David.
Uh-huh. And how'd you meet him?
Actually, I met him years ago, like 10 years ago or something.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. He and Tom used to work together.
Uh-oh. Another lawyer.
I know, right?
Yeah. You can't have everything.
Anyway, he called for Tom, and I filled him in on what was going on, and he was very compassionate. Turns out that his marriage was also falling apart, and so we met up for drinks, and it turns out that we had a lot in common, and we've been seeing each other ever since.
Well, certainly seems to agree with you.
Oh, it's been...
I think it's great that you're getting your feet wet. Yeah, the hell with Tom.
Well, actually, it's a bit more serious than just wet feet, but, oh, I'm sorry. This is so silly. It's like high school, you know? I'm blushing. Oh, it's so exciting stealing away whenever we can.
How long has this been going on?
A few months.
Uh-huh.
And, we're having such a good time.
Wait, a few months?
He is teaching me how to rollerblade.
Oh, my God.
It's so fun. I'm getting pretty good at it, too. We play hooky sometimes, and he takes me out to, you know, along the canal.
Do you wear knee pads and a helmet and everything?
Yes.
Because you could really hurt yourself on those things.
It's fun. You should try it. We'll give you and Gabe a lesson.
Oh, yeah, just Gabe. Yeah, I can see it.
Oh, he is so full of life, David. He's just so open and optimistic, and he's a playmate. That's what he is. He's just a wonderful playmate.
Boy, that was fast.
What?
Well, Tom is barely out the door.
Oh, Karen.
You didn't want to be alone for a while?
Well, I've always been alone. Don't you understand?
Years.
I spent my whole marriage alone.
Yeah, but to get involved with someone right away?
I'm in love with him.
How could you be in love with him?
I am.
Well, you've only just started seeing him.
I knew him years ago, I said.
Well, through Tom.
Right. We went out socially a few times, the two couples.
Yeah, but that's different.
I mean, it's it's not like he's a stranger. The preliminaries were out of the way. There's a history there. There was already a type of shorthand.
Okay, I can understand it's being exciting. I can understand that. But love?
Well, why is it so hard to believe? I fell in love with Tom after that first weekend at the vineyard.
Okay, and look where that got you.
Karen.
Sorry. I think you have to be careful.
Oh, please.
You are very vulnerable right now. I don't want you to get hurt.
I'm going to marry him. David is not Tom. He's not. He is a very different man. There is no hidden agenda with him. What you see is what you get, you know? He talks to me. He tells me what he's thinking. He lets me in. So much of my marriage with Tom was this dark little tango, this adagio dance, and I don't want that anymore. I want another shot at it with David. And David wants me.
I wish you well.
Thanks. He's so great with the kids. Really, you should see him with them. They're all over him, especially Sammy. Mm-hmm. Things got so gloomy after Tom left. You have no idea.
No, I know.
I never thought that my children would laugh again. I mean it. It was that grim.
I'm sure.
I know what I'm doing, Karen. This is the man that I was meant to be with. I really believe that. I had to survive Tom in order to end up with David. It was my fate.
Okay, I that may be, but still, I wish that you would give it more time.
And let this moment pass? No way. I don't want to let this... Why do I even bother?
What?
You think I'm crazy.
I never said that.
This is my opportunity. My opportunity for a real marriage, a real partnership. But you don't want me to have that, do you?
What an outrageous thing to say. Of course I do.
I am finally feeling whole, finally feeling like I am on the right track for the first time in my life. And what do? You undermine it.
I am not undermining you.
Oh.
I'm only thinking about what's best for you.
Oh, I see.
Try being alone for a while. That's
what
I would do.
What is so great about being alone, huh?
I would indulge myself. Get to know myself
better.
Oh, that
is easy for you to say. You have Gabe and you have this life.
Beth.
You know what I think? I think that you love it when I am a mess.
What?
You do. You love it when I am all over the place flailing about. I finally find someone who is like an anchor in my life, and you don't want to hear about it.
That is not true.
As long as I am artsy and incompetent, everything is fine. But the minute that I show any signs of being on an equal footing with you, you don't want to have it and you want to knock me over.
How can you say
that?
Oh,
come on. You need me to be a mess. You're invested in it. Every Karen needs a Beth.
That really isn't fair.
We all play the parts that we're given. I was the mess, the ditz, the comic relief, and you got to be Miss Perfect. Just the right wine, and just the right spice, and just the right husband. How could I even compete with that?
No one is asking you to compete with anything.
You're right. There was no contest. I couldn't even possibly reciprocate. I mean the hostess gifts that you would give. I could never tell if you were being remedial or just plain hostile.
I had no idea that you felt this way.
We can't all be like you, Karen. God knows that I have tried, but, you know, no matter how much I stir the pot, my soup always sticks to it.
Look, we loved nothing more than having you in our home and cooking you meals.
I know, we loved it too.
You're my family.
I know.
I have spent the past first 20 years doing whatever the hell I could do to get away from my family, and my second 20 years doing everything I could to cobble together a family of my own. You know, I thought that if I could choose my family this time, if I could make my friends my family.
Well, congratulations. The family you chose is just as screwed up and fallible as the one you were born into.
That was a scene from Donald Margulies' Dinner with Friends.
And we now bring to the stage Happier Valley improviser Pam Victor, who has no idea what she's walking into.
You sure you don't mind eating outside?
Oh, I love eating outside.
I feel like I haven't seen you in ages.
No, it's been like a thousand years.
You look wonderful. You really do.
Good, too.
We were very worried about you.
Well, worry not. I'm 100% fine, 90% fine. I'm good. I mean, I'm like, I'm back. I'm almost back.
Well, you disappeared on us.
I did. I went out to California, did the California thing. I thought I was going to be like a famous actor.
Yeah, I'd leave messages and you wouldn't call me right back.
No, I wanted to look cool. Like, I was so busy being a famous actor.
You're not mad at me or anything, are you?
No, why would I be mad at you? Just because you're out here on Broadway, you know, got the soap. It's an evening soap. I saw you on the Colbert Report. No, I'm super, super, super happy for you, Janice. I'm really delighted.
I don't know. When this thing first happened, we talked all the time.
I know. We were both gonna make it. We're gonna be there together. You and me. The Janice and Sam show.
You dropped by all the time.
We were the best of friends. We had big plans.
No.
I had big plans.
Are you sure that I didn't offend you in some way?
Jan, it's not that you offended me. It's just that you succeeded more than me.
You don't think on some level you blame me for the whole thing?
No, I totally blame you for the whole thing. It's like you were out there pushing all the time. We'd go out for the same part. That's why I had to move out west. We'd go out for the same parts and you just like...
It was my idea to introduce you.
I know, and see how that worked out. You introduced me to the director, and then, oh, weird, you got the part.
Yep, but I set the whole thing in motion. All the rancor and the rage.
That's on you, sis.
The pain that the kids are going through.
That's on you, sis.
So I guess you immersed yourself in your work all this time?
Well, work. I mean, I didn't work a lot. It was mostly the Cheesecake Factory.
Which was probably the healthiest thing you could do.
Shut up! It's like 20 pounds!
How come?
Because cheesecake is good, Janice. Have you had the marble cheesecake? There's chocolate and cheese. It's like the perfect storm.
Oh, that'll pass.
Some of it passes, some of it sticks around.
Why?
Why? Because I'm basically lactose intolerant and I don't digest cheese. That's the other kick in the ass about my life now.
No.
I work at the Cheesecake Factory and I can't eat cheese anymore.
How can you say that? After all these years, after all that hard work.
All that hard cheese. Parmesan now and then, but no. I come and I see you and I just see the missed opportunity.
No, that's...
It's the same way I feel with a nice wheel of camembert.
It's not true. You're very good.
You're not that good of an actor.
I like your stuff.
Oh, shut up, Janice. How's it been? All rosy and fantastic here?
Wow.
Is it good, fame? Do you love it when someone walks down the street and they come up to you and they're like, oh my God, I know you. Selfie with me.
Yes, and what have you been doing yourself all winter?
I've been taking pictures of people having their birthdays at the Cheesecake Factory.
Good.
Screw you. You have always been jealous of me, Janice.
Oh, you little devil.
Oh, you little devil or devilly devil.
Oh, yeah. Isn't that great?
I know. Okay, I've been taking some improv classes and they haven't kicked in yet, okay?
Oh, what's his name?
All right, that's true. There's always somebody.
Uh-huh.
You might recognize his name. It's John Malkovich.
How'd you meet him?
I am being John Malkovich.
Oh, yeah?
You see stars out there all the time. He came in with his wife.
Uh-oh.
I waited on him.
Another lawyer.
Well, she's gonna hire a lawyer for the divorce, and then he's all mine. Mrs. John Malkovich.
Oh, well, you can't have everything.
No, but I can have him.
Uh-huh.
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 Uh-huh! Well,
I knew you always liked him. When we were kids, John Malkovich's poster was on your wall. In the closet. I saw it. Hidden.
Well, it certainly seems to agree with you.
Yes, it does. John and I are in love. He is so weird, and I like it.
I think it's great that you're getting your feet wet.
I am getting so much wetter than that.
The hell with Tom!
Oh, is it not working out with Mr. Hanks? Oh, he isn't as nice as he looks, is he?
How long has this been going on?
6 months.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, it's been great. John and I. Me and John Malkovich.
A few months.
Yes, just a few months.
Oh, God.
Why are you so upset about it?
Do you wear knee pads?
Sister, I have so many calluses built up on my knees by now, I don't need knee pads.
And a helmet?
Yes, a helmet I need, yes.
And everything?
The pads, the works.
Oh, God.
It's raunchy and quasi. Gray's Anatomy, but the other gray where you tie people up. 50 Shades of Gray, but it's like 50 Shades of Red Hot Love between me and John Malkovich, and I've got the cutest bike helmet. It's got stars on it.
Because you could really hurt yourself on those things.
Yeah.
Yeah, I can just see Gabe.
He would never be into that.
Oh. Boy, that was fast.
That's what she said.
Tom is barely out the door.
Really?
You didn't want to be alone for a while?
No, I like going from man to man.
Well, you haven't been alone in a dozen years.
I don't need alone. I have the echo inside my head constantly.
But to get involved with someone right away,
look, the breakup was awful, and I just needed someone new, and John walked into the Cheesecake Factory, and our eyes met, and I said, would you like strawberry topping? And he said, yes.
How could you be in love with him?
Are you kidding? Have you seen John Malkovich? Those bizarre eyes, the way they bore into your soul. You always think he's thinking about murder, but he's not.
But you've only just started seeing him.
I know. And already, we're like soulmates. He says I get to be in his next movie.
Oh, through Tom.
Yeah. We're working with Tom Hanks. Oh, are you going to be in it?
That's different.
If Tom loved you, he'd put you in his movie.
I can understand it's being exciting. I can understand that.
It's super exciting. There are helmets and knee pads. Janice, that's pretty much the definition of exciting in love.
But love?
Yeah, love. It's not just lust. So when I'm standing there in the harness, looking down on John Malkovich as he's wearing that little Bo Peep outfit, all I feel is love. See?
And now, our scripted actress Sandra Blaney returns to the stage, and for the first time, please welcome Happier Valley improviser Christine Stevens.
This place is great. I feel so relaxed.
Not at all.
Really? You look relaxed.
Well, the sun feels great.
It does. Oh, man, that skylight. Amazing.
I know!
It's like we could get a tan inside.
Thank you!
Well done, you.
Really?
I mean, totally. Are we going to get to anything substantial here?
I didn't mean to.
Okay, all right, I know. We start out with the, you know, superficial friendly stuff, but, you know, what's on your mind? What's going on?
I know, I'm sorry. I needed some time by myself, you know.
Yeah, I had to chase you down. I had to follow you.
Look, you're mad.
A little bit.
Yeah.
I, if you wanted to go to your grandparents' cabin, you know, and need some time alone, you could have told me. No, instead I had to follow you and track you down because you just left. Nothing.
Mad at you?
Clearly.
Why should I be mad at you?
Well, you tell me. I don't know.
I know.
Well, that's kind of what I was concluding here, is that one of us knows why you're mad at me. And since it's not me, I think it might be you.
I thought you were getting sick of me.
Oh, my God. Susan, is that it? Oh, no. I tracked you down to your grandparents' cabin.
Well, I was getting sick of me.
Oh. Well, wait a minute. What? Why? I mean, why would you get sick of you? You're just the most interesting friend I have.
Karen.
Susan.
Well, why would you have offended me?
Okay, you know, truth time. I just, oh God, how do I say this? It's just, sometimes you're a little controlling.
Oh, God, this is ridiculous.
See, I knew it. I knew that would happen. Okay, that's why I haven't said anything before. Because you take things really... I mean, we can't have like a rational discussion about it, but maybe up here in the woods with the skylight and the sun, we could have a rational discussion about your very controlling nature. So what? That's as good as you got, so what?
We were grown-ups. We knew what we were doing.
Yeah, but you didn't have to be hovering over my back every time I was trying to do that new computer program. You were just like on me.
It was out of our control.
No, it was out of your control. That was the problem.
That we came together was as much out of our control as our falling apart.
Well, yeah, we came together in fourth grade, you know. I mean, like, that does happen to people, right? But yes, now there is a rift, and we are here to repair it. And I feel confident we can. Do you want a soda or something? You want anything to...
You can't control everything, Karen, even though you think that you can.
Oh. I see. It's a little... We're in opposite land now, because I just said... You're the controlling one, and now you're calling me the controlling one.
Well...
Okay, that's fun. All right.
Actually, no.
Actually, no what?
I haven't been in my studio in weeks.
I know, and that's why you're crazy! If you don't paint, you go nuts.
The pressure to paint has totally lifted.
Wow. Wow. But you're still nuts.
Oh, no, no. I'm not worried about it. Oh. Well, I don't want to paint anymore.
Okay, wait, Susan, that's a little bit of a problem. Just because you've got a couple of commissions in your studio right now that you need to finish.
Right.
And that you need the money.
After Tom left.
Right, he left you penniless, so you got out there, woman artist, did it, and I was the best friend, fostering you up, helping you.
Like this unburdening.
Yeah.
Took place.
Took place, yeah. Stuff.
I have looked at my life and what I've been doing, and it seems so insignificant to me.
Oh, Susan. No.
Yes.
You are a genius artist.
No.
You are not significant. You are going to be one of the premier female artists of this century. I am sure of it. I am sure of it.
I realize that Tom was right.
What was Tom? Tom was never right about anything. He was a schmuck.
No. I was using my painting as a reason not to get on with my life.
No, painting is your life, Susan. It was your life, and why do you listen to Tom? He was just nothing but trouble.
Let's face it.
What?
I was never very good.
Didn't I just say something about premier artist, 20th century, 20... Oh, no, we're 21st now. Whatever.
Karen.
I'm not just blowing smoke up your new you-know-what.
You don't have to say that anymore.
Okay, I see. Look, maybe my father can make some calls to some galleries. Maybe we could get something going for you. Maybe we're going to push this along. I'm your friend. I'm going to help you with that.
In therapy twice a week.
Well, yeah, you've always needed that. That's good. You know, crazy artist, you fit that whole stereotype. Not me. Not boring old me. Work at the bank. Boring Karen.
And?
And what? And, okay, I work at the bank and I'm a kick-ass knitter. I can knit a hat and...
I'm seeing someone.
You have Tom, who just left you, but now you're seeing someone. Well, good on you, because that's another thing that's not going on in my life, but hey, no big deal. Tell me about him. Tell me about him.
Well, he's a wonderful man.
Of course he is. And yes, and he's, you met
David.
Him. David, okay. Did you meet him at
Actually, I met him years ago.
Oh, years
like,
ago.
Like 10 years ago or something.
Nice,
yeah.
Nice. Well, that's great. Congratulations.
He and Tom used to work together.
Oh. Did you, like, have something with...
Yeah.
While you were...
Right.
Ooh. Ooh. Wow. Well, you know, c'est la vie, la vie de l'artiste, you know?
Anyway.
Boy, nothing...